Okay, good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk about CyanogenMod, how we've taken it from Steve sitting in his bedroom working at home to working on devices such as the OnePlus and the U, which was announced yesterday, and how that looks at from a developer standpoint with our community. So, who am I? My name is Abhisek Devkota. I am developer relations at Cyanogen Inc. I also run senior engineering inside of Cyanogen Inc. And on the open source side of CyanogenMod, I've been participating for about 6 years now, so maybe 6 months after the initial release. You can find me at Twitter or a Google search for Swirl. It's a pretty unique handle at the bottom there. I'm on Google+, Facebook, everything as well. So for a show of hands real quick, how many of you actually know what CyanogenMod is? Good, perfect. That makes this part easy. Instead of me doing a little spiel, I figured I'd do a little cool one here. This is actually an excerpt from a Cory Doctorow book called Homeland. He's an author, a blogger, an activist. He does a lot of things about a proponent for open source code. And so this is what he had to say in actually one of his books. I knew about CyanogenMod, of course. Hackers had taken the open source Google code and made it fully free and open version that can do all kinds of tricks. So at a base level, that's very true. We take the Android open source project, we make it work on platforms outside of the Nexus devices. So AOSP out of its box supports about 6 or 7 devices today. We have on KitKat 163 as of yesterday morning, supporting KitKat with CyanogenMod. We are also a public entity, so you can find us on CyanogenMod.com, and we also have a lot of privacy features as well, which we'll jump into a little bit later. Another interesting note about Cory is all of his work is also open underneath the Creative Commons non-commercial license, so he open sources his books, which is actually a pretty neat thing. So, from a hobby to a movement. We've been doing this about 6 years. Android came out in early 2008 with the G1 picking up traction towards the end of the year. Steve was our founder, started on the G1. He actually built on top of the existing XDA development system created by a hacker named Jesus Freak, who now works at Google. He is responsible for the Dalvik and Art project, if you're familiar with Art, with Lollipop. So the folks and names in this deck are a good core part of what Android has become over the past 6 years. And then we've done significant firsts with our open source code. Xiaomi was able to launch about 5 years ago. They used our code base for that. The Ubuntu Touch project is also using CyanogenMod code initially for their kernel sources, because we do a lot of the legwork that they wouldn't have to do for porting Android to other devices and using a third-party OS. About 2 years ago today, we launched Cyanogen Inc., which was a corporate entity, one to support the growth of CyanogenMod and take on bigger projects, which we'll touch on a little bit later, but also to take on product retail in terms of software engineering. So we have partnerships with OnePlus and now with Micromax with the U platform that Rahul so graciously spoke about yesterday. So the fun stuff. In the beginning, we were absolutely chickens with our heads cut off. We had no idea what we were doing. I was a student at the time, participating in college, probably similar to a lot of you trying to figure out what I was doing with my life. We didn't have a plan. There was no roadmap. There was no vision. It was just, here's Android. It's something new. It's something cool. It's Linux-based. Let's see what we can do with it, which was fantastic, because it allowed for a lot of innovation to go really, really quickly. If any of you remember Android in its infancy, it was missing a lot of things that we take for granted these days. There was no store. There was no multi-touch. The behaviors and experiences were very just rudimentary. And so there was a lot of gaps that a lot of companies identified, and we saw those same gaps through the open source code, and we just started plugging them with our own innovative and novel features to go with it. This had a trade-off, though. While it was great for hackers, and it was fantastic for incorporating new functionality, what ended up happening was we had settings upon settings upon settings upon settings. And if there was a feature idea, we didn't have the wherewithal or the really just confidence to say, no, that's not a good feature, or no, that doesn't make sense. We just said, okay, you can have it, we'll merge it in, and we'll make it a setting somewhere. So if you look at the early days of CyanogenMod, I dare you to find something within 30 seconds if you know what you're looking for. I get lost within those versions as well. As we continued to grow, myself, Steve, maybe five other people started, for lack of a better word, a developer interest. We wanted to bring people in, especially with the push that Verizon did around marketing for the initial Droid platform inside of the US. That was that horrible robotic Droid sound. So that brought in a lot of new fresh blood, because before that it was just the G1 and the MyTouch, Ion phone. So with that, we started getting a lot of interest from outside sources on actually contributing back to the project. And initially, we were using just GitHub pull requests. And so what ended up happening there was, yes, there was sizable amounts of code coming through, but it wasn't the best interface for code reviews or even code management or discussion. GitHub has a really good comment system, but it's not scaled and in tune for what we were using. So we launched our Garrett instance. Garrett is the tool that Google uses in-house to do their code reviews. It has various API hooks that you can use for continuous integration and Jenkins instances. So it worked out really well for us. And then this was our effort at coordination. This is a Google Drive folder. This was how we brought in new developers. And so if you were a CyanogenMod contributor, we gave you access to a folder, and the folder was absolutely garbage. It still is. I mean, there's some important pieces there, that the CVE checklist to make sure that we're up to date on every CVE that makes a public round across all the devices. You can imagine doing the kernel patches for 153 devices for a CVE can get tedious. But this was our organization, and this is not conducive to a lot of things, especially planning. So with the Garrett instance up, and we started getting a lot of contributions, we were overwhelmed. We didn't know, with the five of us that were actually managing Garrett, how to handle the basis of, we have so many more contributors, so many more patches coming through, and we were routinely about 60 days behind on code reviews. And the reasoning for that is, well, code reviews are fine if your peers are doing it for you, but the merges are within the hands of five people. And if those five people don't get through the code review in time, and you need to rebase changes, you need to recode review, and then it just becomes this really tedious process. So we settled on what the Apache Software Foundation uses in-house for their own development, which is this concept of a meritocracy. So it's not a democracy. We don't vote. There is no show of hands for how things should be merged or what should be going. We base it on the capabilities of the actual contributor. So if you've been a contributor for 3 months and your work is consistently good, we'll give you merge rights or code review protocol over a specific project. And so what this does really well is scales for our needs. We bring in about three device maintainers every month, and with them come usually a little team of folks that they've been using for external testing on unofficial builds and XDA contributions and so on. So we can actually scale this so that they are in charge of their own platform and they're in charge of their own projects, and then we can give permissions to merge rights outside of the hands of just myself, Steve, or Kosh, or the others that you may be familiar with, and then it's a self-sustaining system. They can just keep their code reviews moving along, they all have a core concept of what we're working towards, and they can go on from there. So some growing pains that we've seen. The settings upon settings upon settings things really bit us with CM7. CM7 was the gingerbread release of CyanogenMod, and it was a messy release. If you used it on one of your devices, it's probably the most still in use wide scale because Gingerbread just won't die for the love of it. But it is just feature overload. I think there's about 12 different lock screens that we bundled into the OS, all with settings to be go with it. There's a horribly invasive permissions control system that breaks a lot of third-party apps, because at the time, we weren't really thinking about a larger ecosystem. We weren't thinking about being conducive and playing nice with that. So CM9 with the ice cream sandwich and the subsequent skip of Honeycomb, which never existed, we got an opportunity to start over fresh. And so we actually sat down and said, you know, we have this brand new code base, and it looks radically different from a software architecture point, but it also looks radically different from a UI standpoint. And so why don't we just take what we have and reimagine all of them and re-implement all of them to be as if they were a part of the OS from the beginning. And that was one of the things that CM9 ushered in that CM7 didn't bother with. And so CM9 was very much our start of actually having a vision and a user story to tell beyond just hackers. So this does pose an issue with open source platforms. Particularly, not everyone's fond of starting over, and not everyone's fond of not having that overkill. And so we saw a lot of rise in external projects, particularly example would be AOKP. And so AOKP very much lived within the ethos of CM7, which was more is better. And so they would have a lot more features than we would end up having in CM9. But I feel that they suffered from what we suffered in CM7 and had to learn that same issue as they grew their code base as well, which is maintaining all that code, whether you have 20 or 100 features, becomes chaotic when you have multiple contributors who have access to maintain and modify that code. And we are pretty hands-off in terms of management of our open source contributions, because we find that, you know, with too much management, there you start killing some of the innovation, right? And so we try to stay hands-off, and the vision change will just made it other folks want to do new things, which is fantastic. That's how open source works, but we did lose some capable folks to that. So we had more of an emphasis on our user experience and then as well as the documentation. One of the things with Android is Google does a decent job of documenting their Java docs and so on, but for the purpose of our developer community, it's basically if you wanted to do anything with respect to third-party operating systems, you had to do a Google search and hopefully you got a good guide. And so we put a very conscious effort in terms of our documentation. Our wiki instance got an overhaul to make sure that it was up to date for everything. So documentation became another one of our core strengths in terms of moving forward. And then things progressed from there. As we had a core vision, we started specking out ideas for larger platform plays, features that would be multiple months projects to work on. So Arnav had a talk yesterday on NFC, and one of the things we did was take a bet on a host card emulation. And so within CyanogenMod, we worked with the folks at SimplyTap, who were creating a mobile wallet using host card emulation, and they innovated that technology, which eventually made its way into Jelly Bean's release of AOSP. So that bet paid off pretty well. The permissions controls were removed from CM7 and replaced with Privacy Guard, which has since evolved over the years to include what Google's done for their AppOps model, which I imagine they're using for an MDM solution. We started coordinating releases. Releases with CM have always been a fun time for us prior to any coordination. You can imagine with Jelly Bean, we had about 75 devices within the first month for release, and we actually didn't have a schedule. There was, okay, we've done enough work, it's been maybe 2 months, let's do a release now. Which was great because you got those features out, but it wasn't great because the code hadn't actually stabilized. We were still pushing code the night before, and we just marked it, tagged it, shipped it, and kicked it out the door. And so once we started accumulating users, especially in the millions, that started being a really bad thing. Like the overwhelming feedback was, no, this is just broken. And so that became another element that we hadn't accounted for, which was people actually depended on this as a daily platform instead of just us tinkering. So with our proper release schedule, which we finally actually hit with CM11, we have a monthly cadence of a snapshot release, which is tagged, tested, and shipped. And so that if you can imagine, we've been doing this for 6 years, and CM11 is KitKat, and we finally got to it. It's been one of the hardest things that we've had to deal with, because when you're coordinating with volunteers around the world, and you expect them to sit there and test their own platforms with their own daily lives, it becomes hard. We also introduced our Jira, and our Jira has taken on many faces over the last 2 years. Our Jira is responsible for our bug tracking. We moved off of the Google Code site. But it also does our research for future requests and improvements and enhancements. There's about 1,100 outstanding requests today. Not to say that I'm going to go and create 1,100 new features, but this is one of the core things that puts us at the forefront of adoption amongst the enthusiast community, is that they may not be technically capable, right? I'm talking to a room of developers or folks that are studying, but the average user doesn't actually know what it would take to make a system-wide change or anything like that. And so this became a really good voice for integration back, and it became a feedback loop. We would introduce a new nightly with a new feature. We would get immediately feedback saying, wow, that's a really good feature, but I feel like this should work in this way. And it's one of the key benefits that we have as we move towards CyanogenMod Inc. as well, is this immediate feedback loop. If I'm testing an application or creating a new application, I can introduce it into a nightly build, and it will instantly be tested, crowdsourced by 20 million users. And so that kind of feedback has been immensely helpful for our growth. We introduced the heads-up notification system that's now standard in Lollipop, actually into CM11 about 4 months ago, prior to the developer release, preview releases of Lollipop from Google. And so we got a lot of feedback for what we're going to be implementing into CM12, which will be based on Lollipop, based on that head start we got with that code, and that feedback that's in those feature requests and enhancement requests. But there's still points of failure. We got bit really hard about a year and a half. No, it's probably 2.5 now. Our code is meritocracy. Our Garrett is self-sustaining. Our Jira, they have developer access. They can close, start their own workflows. But our server infrastructures were all single points of failure, meaning that there was usually one person that owned the website side, one person owned the forum side, and one person owned the build clusters. And so you can see where this can break down very easily. If the person's out of town, missing, on vacation, or in one instance, malicious, we're essentially crippled. And so we actually lost total control of our domain for about a month, and we switched over to CyanogenMod.org for a while there, over one of these issues. And so that has been a lot of lessons by trial by fire. Right. We want to go into this with open hearts and open minds and say, you know, we're trusting of everyone that wants to come in and be participating and be useful. But we've had to put our guard up for a few more things and put more access controls around the server side of things to make it more robust and similar to the Garrett instance. Another thing is we've slowed down in terms of our stable releases. Right, we have the monthly snapshots. We don't really do stables anymore, and a perception issue has kicked in over the last maybe 2 to 3 years, which is because you are now taking more time to focus on quality and user experience. A lot of people think that the innovation side of CM has gone away. I would argue that spending time and the extra time to make sure that the functionality that you're introducing is actually a benefit to the end user is a lot more rewarding than being able to say you have this list of features. One of the most favorite ones that we just recently introduced is if you long click on a notification from a game that says, hey, you should also install this other game for 20% cheaper, or like an ad, you don't want to disable notifications from the game per se, because you may get push notifications when it's your turn to play or whatever the case may be. So we actually added in a filter, a spam filter. Basically, we do a regex match against the notification by package name. And so if we ever see that package spam you again with that kind of message, we can just never show it to you, and it'll sit in your notification center if you ever wanted to go see it again. And so that kind of innovative feature, that one actually came from that same Jira list that was coming earlier. There was a external project called Exposed. Maybe some of you have used it. It does a runtime injection of Java code. Really messy. But they had a feature similar to this, and somebody said, well, you know, that's actually a pretty good idea. And we said, yeah, that makes sense for a lot of people, and it makes sense at a global scale. And so that's the kind of things that we look for when we're taking that feedback loop, which is, you know, there's niche, and then there's applicable to the crowd. But the most important part about our growth over the last 6 years has been relationships. Code and technical merit and people, they all boil down to how you can interact with folks. People will give you all kinds of really good stuff, because there's a lot of really technical people all over the world, right? There's smart people everywhere. And they will give you, you know, meaningful features with stories behind them, privacy improvements, customizations, and focus on the user. They'll do what you want them to do and what you want your product to focus on. But if you can't maintain what those features are, and you can't maintain that relationship and that open dialogue with your contributors, you're never going to get that kind of traction in an open source platform. It's easy to look at the Linux kernel because it's been established for so long. But one of the early things was Linus has a pretty rough personality, right? He's a smart guy, but when he sees something wrong, he's very quick to point it out. And that's, over the course of the years, been called out many times. And now he has a team of folks working with him to maintain the kernel. But molding that relationship to be beneficial to the end product is one of the hardest things that I've had to do as a developer manager here. Looking at the our Jira instance here, this is actually the Jira project for CM11 or CM12, which is due out in about 2 months. In comparison to that Google Drive folder that I showed you, where we were trying to do feature planning, I have now actual reports that I can generate out on how features are going, estimates of timeframes. With the Cyanogen Inc. resources, I can actually give engineers towards some of the harder problems that our open source features are causing or encountering. This gives a lot of visibility for a company into the open source project, but it also lets the open source project see that the company is actively supporting and helping and engaging. So that brings us to the company. Cyanogen Inc. was about 2 years ago. And the moment we announced it, the moment you say there's money involved in an open source project, you get that knee-jerk reaction, which is, well, you've just sold out. And I hear it every day, and it's been 2 years, and I get this question a lot, is, how does the fact that you have a board of directors and a corporate interest and a corporate mandate affect what you're doing with CyanogenMod? And when we initially announced, we lost about 5 maintainers to a separate project, and they weren't happy with the decision to introduce this new angle. But this is interesting. The knee jerk is one thing. I can understand that. There's been a lot of open source projects over the course of time that have gone dark because corporate interests killed them. But then you have these lights in the darkness, Mozilla, Red Hat. Red Hat does open source first, right? They essentially sell open source as a service. They give you all the code, and then they sell you these enterprise solutions on top. Mozilla has been very good with its MPL license for the browser, and so you see all these Gecko clones of the Firefox browser. So as long as the core interest of the community is maintained, you can actually introduce money and resources to help benefit that. We support our developers with build servers. They're about $9,000 each. Very powerful instances. You can imagine we do 150 builds a night of Android, and so if some of you had built Android, that's a pretty long build cycle. And so we've also introduced their capability to run one-off builds. And so if they're a college kid who can't afford a powerful laptop, they can SSH into these build servers, build directly against the server, and test their deployments there, which is one of the many things that we do to encourage that kind of open growth amongst new contributors. And then the same as the meritocracy argument earlier, by announcing a new entity, CyanogenMod Inc., we had to re-earn the trust of everyone that we've worked with over the last 6 years. I've called these folks my friends. I've gone to parties and dinners with them. But the money thing always introduces a wrinkle. So one of the first things I did was draft a new governance policy, basically providing a segregation between what is CyanogenMod Inc. and what is CyanogenMod, what happens when there is a conflict of interest between the two. How do we handle rights and responsibilities between the two as well? Because you can imagine the corporate side has product interests. They want to make these hardware platforms. And some of these things need differentiation, the U brand versus any other brand that we work on. But we don't want that to step all over the work of the open source folks either, because one of the appeals of CyanogenMod is that it's so neutral. It's a blank canvas for a lot of people to do a lot of things. And if we start going too heavily skewed in terms of closed source or apps that are specific to India versus somewhere else, you start breaking that model down. We also continue to focus on our open source, and so all of our apps are built on top of the existing open source applications, not secondary closed source. Actually, the entire product that's on the U platform that's launching is actually already open source. The only part that we haven't put up is the device and kernel tree. Every other piece of software that is not one of the special apps that we've done for them is already up there and available to clone. We also were able to do larger bets on bigger technologies from the last talk, especially with the chat. WhisperPush is the text secure protocol developed by Moxie Marlinspook. Most recently, I believe they're working with WhatsApp to integrate their end-to-end encryption services. We actually introduced that same encryption service into CM11 just out after our public announcement about a year ago. And so this is something that is federated with TechSecure, and so if you are a CM WhisperPush user or a TechSecure user, you're now compatible to that entire network of encrypted messaging. We're evaluating what the new WhatsApp deal does as well, because you can imagine that just introduced millions of more people into that exact same network. And so this bet actually paid off pretty well for us, in that we've managed to tap into a technology at its forefront just before the encryption scare of the US government and everything else that's going on around the world. And so that's a big win for us there. Another one that we're recently announced was NextBit, which is a device-to-device sync and backup solution. So Google has an existing backup solution which will get you your apps back from the Play Store and your cursory information, such as Wi-Fi and widget placement on the home screen. And then they also introduced Google Play for Games, which does game sync across the platform. But what we identified as a gap between what Google had and when we look at a model such as iOS, if you lose a phone on an iPhone, you plug it back into iTunes and you have a clone, right? It's exactly the way you left it. Now, the community had done something similar using Nandroid inside of recovery. They were essentially taking system dumps and being able to restore that back. What NextBit does is actually introduces an API. The API itself is open source. It's inside of our frameworks and security stuff. But NextBit's protocol allows that device-to-device sync and restore for other apps, so messaging, games that don't use Play of Games, and settings that normally you wouldn't be able to do as a backup through GCM or cloud existing solution. So hopefully Nextbit takes off really well. We're running a beta trial, I believe, on their website this month. So if you're interested in participating in that, any CM build after 3 weeks ago is already Nextbit capable. So you are eligible if you have a device that participates. We're also investing heavy into SDKs for more CM-specific APIs. So we have the themes engine, which has been a very big focus for us for the last year. We rewrote it from the ground up using a part of a solution that was given by Sony to AOSP about 5 years ago. And then we made it runtime instead of build time, and then some additional enhancements there. So if you're a designer and you create icon packs or you're interested in the theming side, the source is up. There's a theme template available through our wiki as well. It's a Gradle and Eclipse capable, so you can just import it and go from there. We also envision introducing more CM-specific APIs. The gentleman who spoke on yesterday morning, early morning, was talking about app-to-app communication, right? And I actually agree and disagree with parts of his talk. App-to-app communication is the future, but I don't believe it's going to come the way that he thought it would, which would be an example. You get an email message through to your standard email client, and Foursquare detects that you've finally gotten to where that location was and checks you in. The reason I don't see it working that way is because the information contained in those apps, particularly the metadata, the user information, is essentially what is driving those apps' growth. So Facebook is very unlikely to give their information for free to Twitter to do that cross-interaction. So what we envision happening is more so a glue that will sit between all these components. And so we're writing an API. It's already available on our GitHub instance. That essentially will allow multiple apps to publish into one cohesive space. And you'll get the cursory information from that app. So say you have a Facebook feed and a Twitter feed, it'll be one feed consistent. And if you tap through, you'll get to Facebook and you'll get to Twitter. We think this is a more viable solution in that when we propose it to folks, it's not, hey, give me your data. It's just, hey, here's an API that will allow me to publish your content, and it will actually encourage user interaction with your application. Because if it's available, think of Blink Feed from HTC, right? If it's available directly on your home screen, and it's, oh, I just saw a new picture come through that my friend posted, but I'm not tagged, that content will still surface, and you can get into it contextually and launch directly into that engagement. So we see a lot of growth coming from there, and look for more specific things on that coming soon. And of course, that's open source as well. With the hardware platforms that we're creating, there's been an increased focus, obviously, on quality assurance. When we were just community-based, we could very easily say, well, it's a community ROM. They chose to install it. It's their fault. You know, beware, user, buyer beware. When you're purchasing hardware, that's not something that no sane company would say that. So quality assurance has been one of the main focuses for us for the past 2 years. So we have continuous integration using Lava, which is, I believe, Linaro makes the tool, and Garrett in our Jenkins instance. And so we can actually test every new code change that gets submitted into Garrett directly and deployed. We also have apps on the Play Store, which are using this exact system. And so we can actually do remote deployment, build, test, verify, and publish, which has been a really good win for us. Google gives a fair amount of unit tests within AOSP. A lot of them are broken. But there's never been a conscious effort prior to the last 2 years for CM-specific testing. We would just write the feature, and then our testing was really the nightly users, right? And then that would be what would flesh out the bugs. So there's been a very heavy push for unit testing against the CM-specific functionality. There is also the CTS compatibility test suite. This is required to get Google Play certification on any device that's sold. It takes about 8 hours to run. It sucks. It basically tests every component of core Android. So we are CTS compliant against all the hardware devices that we have available. And then when we talk about you and other devices that we're working on, there's regional certifications, regional testing, RF testing, SAR value testing that are specific to the India region versus other markets. And so this is my third or fourth trip to India in the last 2 months. So you know we're here often working on this platform. But at the end of the day, the promise is to keep core to the open source nature of the project. And so the company is, instead of saying, yeah, we're going to keep repeating that message over and over again, we'll just continue to show it, right? The unit testing tools that we've done, the services testing tools that we're developing are also being open source. And because we feel that open source got us where we are, open source opened a lot of opportunities for us as a company. And it also is one of the key components of our innovation factor. And so I'll tweet this out from the CyanogenMod handle after this talk, but there's a little survey up. We're working on some dialer-specific changes and network optimization items for India, and so I'd be curious to get some feedback from that link there. But I'll tweet that out afterwards. All right, so I think we have about 10 minutes for questions.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you have these $9,000 servers and your board of directors and someone mm-hmm. obviously pays you a salary. So where does the money originally come from?
So we are funded by two rounds of investing. So we've gone a Series A and a Series B. Series A was $7 million, Series B was $25 million. These comes from actually a lot of open source proponents and investor companies. So one of our investors is Redpoint, which is actually, and Benchmark, which are actually both supporting Twitter's open source initiatives for their testing tools, and Red Hat as well. So they've had a lot of experience taking open source and making it a product that is, you know, still open.
Hi, Abhisek.
Hi.
This is Ashish. First of all, I'd like to say kudos to your company. I'm a happy CyanogenMod user. So, couple of questions.
Sure.
First of all, if you could give us any snippets of what we can expect in CM12.
So I actually have CM12 running on my device right now. This is the OnePlus. I didn't bring the U model with me. It's locked in the hotel. So with CM12, you'll see...
If you could show it on the screen with the camera.
Is this running?
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Oops, can't have that there. All right. So I'll do this on the OnePlus. One of the new unique features here is if you get a, have you ever used Moto X? Ever seen a Moto X, the ambient display? So the ambient display on the Moto X was basically you get a notification and the lock screen would breathe. It would wake the display and just illuminate the pixels on the AMOLED display exactly where it was because that's one of the capabilities of AMOLED. A lot of people tried to recreate ambient display for multiple devices, particularly in the developer community. They wanted that neat functionality. But it didn't work with LED screens because you need to power up the entire LED to get the display to show up. It doesn't work in the same fashion as AMOLED. And so with the OnePlus and the U platform, the screen, we've actually introduced a feature called Doze Mode, which takes an exact snapshot of the frame buffer of the lock screen itself when the content comes through, and then it breathes that twice at a very, very low power state. And so we've been able to recreate the ambient display using the Doze Mode stuff on devices, and so that's one of the new ones that you'll be seeing. We announced a video a couple weeks ago for the new themes chooser look and feel, which is not actually on this build, but that's coming as well. The other one is the quick settings have fundamentally changed versus what they've done in the past 3 or 4 years. I'd say they took a cue from us in that previously, if you tapped Wi-Fi, it would actually take you into the settings instead of killing Wi-Fi. And so there are more quick shortcuts than quick settings. And so we're reimagining how to do this space in particular, because I think the idea here is really good, and they've started well with the dynamic changes of if you touch something, it'll take over that bottom row for about a 40-day window. But we think we can do a lot more with actually creating an API where if you are an app developer, you can actually generate a quick settings just by being installed. And so you could elevate yourself all the way up to this arguably important dashboard. And so that's in motion as well. Was there another question or?
I wanted to know the story behind the domain trouble. Was it like an internal conflict?
No, so.
You said some malicious thing happened.
It was. So I don't mean to disparage anyone's names, but there was a gentleman who was a contributor for about 4 years, and his contributions were running the websites. He was the first one to host the downloads for CM3, and he sort of stood up the wiki, the web. He did a lot for us. He essentially felt underappreciated. This was before the money came through. This was before there was even a CyanogenMod Inc. It was just, you know, the developers got appreciation because they're always creating these new features and they're getting highlighted every week. And he was more of a behind the scenes kind of guy. And so he thought he was lacking in appreciation. We eventually caught him making deals using CyanogenMod to do referrals to the website as well. That we don't really condone. We don't even have a donate link on the website anymore. If you're, you know, donating, send it to the EFF or somebody that needs it now. And so he was arguably it was a sense of betrayal that he portrayed on us. And so when we asked him to depart and give us control over the domain, and he was the single point of failure for the domain. He was the only one with the keys. He refused. And so we were kind of left in a really hard spot, and that made us question a lot of the judgment decisions that we had done in terms of the trust level for that kind of management.
Hi.
Hi.
My question is from a very app developer point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So like on Android, I use NDK for a lot of stuff. So for developing on CyanogenMod, is it going to be less tedious as compared to Android? Because JNI interactions for Android system services is a big pain.
Yeah. So at its core, CyanogenMod is still Android, right? So everything that you would use to develop on Android will be one-to-one with CyanogenMod.
Right.
Some of the additions that we're doing, the SDK changes that we're adding, are meant to be plug and play and easy for you as an existing app creator to just add a new permission or a new activity. And so it should be very lightweight to make modifications. The glue instance, the API I was speaking about, that works as in that same fashion. It's a permission change. So your Android manifest would get one line change, and then you would have a new activity that we call out. And then we take care of the rest, the generation of the view. And so it's actually very lightweight for yourselves to make modifications to utilize CM-specific stuff.
Hey, thanks for the talk.
Yeah.
Abhisek. I have a question related to how difficult you found it to contribute to the AOSP. Is that still your upstream, or do
so? We have multiple upstreams. We have two in particular. So we use AOSP as our main base, and then we use a lot of code from Qualcomm through Code Aurora, is what they call their platform. And so there's two upstreams there. Contributions to Qualcomm are basically aside for now, right? They do chipset manufacturing and just bare bones bring up. AOSP has a Garrett instance. The issue with AOSP is less that they're not willing to take changes. They're very willing to take changes. It's just you need to be very persistent in talking to people. And it makes me feel like sort of an ass when I do it. But you have to tag people. You have to email them at their Garrett aliases and say, hey, look, this is really essential that you look at. And so they've been quite receptive to some of our changes, especially when it comes to security. They've taken master key exploit from last year, the second one. The patch that's in AOSP is one of ours from a contributor in Lisbon. It's difficult, but it's not because they don't want it. It's just their structure is they're working, right? And you need to basically interject and make them pay attention to your thing.
Thanks. A quick related question.
Yeah.
Do you think AOSP and CyanogenMod have different objectives, like fundamentally objectives different enough for two to exist?
Yes, I do. So AOSP and the Nexus platform are part and parcel, right? They're meant to showcase the next evolution in Android in software and a medium range of premium hardware, right? It's not always the top generation of where that software's or that life cycle of Android's going to be at. So KitKat, when it started, wasn't using as powerful hardware as when it's going to die next year, right? Google tries to aim for that middle ground, that comfort zone. And so by virtue of that, they restrict themselves to the reference platforms that they're working on. So a choice example would be multi-SIM, which is very important to India, was actually not introduced into Android until Lollipop, because when they were developing these reference platforms, it never was a factor for them. Google didn't pay much attention to that because it wasn't in the hardware that they were using as reference. With the introduction of the Android One and things more specific to this region, and now Lollipop, you can see them focusing now on that side of thing. And so CM has had multi-SIM support since our Jelly Bean release. We actually took the Qualcomm implementation because they had an open source stack, which is what most manufacturers here are using anyway. And so we integrated that as the band-aid for the lack of multi-SIM being inside of Google. And so to the point of purposes of AOSP and CM, AOSP's purpose is to showcase Android on those devices, and it's very restricted to that scope of mind. CM's purpose is, one, to enable a lot more creativity and innovation in the platform itself, and the high level of customizations that we have, but also to have high access. And so if you look at AOSP, it only supports 7 devices, and CM across its entire lifecycle now supports over 500 on a build of CM. It's kind of you can see that the focus for us is just distribution, get it on as many platforms to a good state as possible.
How you differentiate Amazon Kindle and CyanogenMod?
What was the?
Amazon Kindle.
Kindle. Yeah, the book, e-reader.
No, it's a custom OS, right? Android.
Fire.
Yeah,
the phone.
Fire OS.
Okay.
Not Fire OS, yeah.
Okay. So the Fire OS, so the question is how to distinguish?
Yeah, between these two.
CyanogenMod
and Amazon.
Okay, all right. So Amazon took the fork concept of AOSP to the whole another level, right? Amazon is quickly growing its own ecosystem of suite of apps, the store, their support apps that they have now. I believe they call it Mayday. And so they've taken Android, and yes, it's still Android, but they're not trying for the total compatibility that is what we're doing here, right? We feel that at this moment, to sell a compelling device, it still needs Google certification. Because if you don't have an ecosystem of apps, the push notification frameworks, it's not a good experience for the end user. And at the end of the day, you're still creating a product there, right? CyanogenMod, the source code itself, is neutral. It doesn't ship with either, right? So if you wanted to install the Amazon suite of apps, you can. If you want the Google suite of apps, you can. If you're in Russia and you want to use Yandex, you can, right? Any store that you choose can be capable of being your CyanogenMod store. On the Cyanogen Inc. devices that we're doing with partners like you, the market right now is still dictating a very Google-heavy experience in buying a retail Android device, and so that's where that's going. I don't think the ecosystem is quite ready for what Amazon tried to do with the Fire Phone. I think the failure of the Fire Phone says a lot about that. But I believe it was just yesterday that Forbes announced that Amazon's working on a Fire Phone 2 to try and correct some of what went wrong. So it'll be interesting to see that side of the world develop as well.
Nowadays, Android battery draining problem is very, battery draining very easily.
On Android?
Android.
Yeah. So battery drain is one, Google Play Services is very heavy on battery. And so Google has done a lot of work over the last, I think, 8 months to address some of those concerns. But they're still holding a lot of wake locks and a lot of cycles. And two, it's the modem reception, right? The signal strength will vary your battery very greatly, particularly when you're looking at a region like India where the towers are, you're at 3G now, just on the cusp of 4G, towers coming out. If you get into a low signal area, your phone is working that much harder. And so one of the things that we're doing with you is looking at software solutions to try and address that. If we know that we're in a bad network area, we can shut down the radio for a little bit and try and conserve some power. Another one of the novel features on the device is a quick boot mode, which is basically hibernate for your cell phone. And so instead of shutting down your phone when you know you're going to be in an office, classroom, somewhere that you can't use a phone for a meaningful time, because entirely powering down your phone takes a lot of juice, and powering it all the way back up takes a lot of juice as well. We actually have a hibernate mode where it'll turn it off and it'll go into a zero power state, and it'll turn back on within 5 seconds. And because it's coming out of the hibernate mode instead. And so it's features like that that we try to work in to make sure that we pay attention to battery life.
What happened with OnePlus?
What happened with OnePlus? I gave them a hug yesterday, didn't you see me? No, Bridget and Vikas and a few of the OnePlus folks were here yesterday. At the end of the day, we've sold devices and we're going to continue to support all the devices that we've sold. The agreements and whatnot are basically, I don't deal with those, but they're in place for contracts, and contracts happen when you're doing business negotiations. But what I don't want, and what no one at CyanogenMod or OnePlus wants, is the users to be left in the dark with support. And so I believe we put out a blog post the other day, and so we'll continue to support the devices. And so hopefully this is just some water under the bridge in a month's time.